programming is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional funding provided by SDN Communications, powering intelligent networks across 8 states. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
And welcome to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live coverage of the State of the State Address. I'm Stephanie Rissler alongside Kara Hetland. Thanks for joining us today in just a few minutes. Governor Dennis Dugard will deliver the State of the State Address to a joint body. We kick off the 87th legislative session today, and it will be an interesting 35 days. Some of the issues expected to come up this session, we'll see some texting and driving issues, some land purchase issues, some stricter requirements when it comes to background checks, and of course education, just general funding overall will be a hot topic this session.
And we've been hinted that the governor is going to lay out about 20 points, 20 proposals for new initiatives. Some include workforce development, and we're anxiously awaiting what he's going to have to say and laying out his initiatives during his State of the State address.
We are live in the House of Representatives. House members just finished some of their house cleaning duties here. The Speaker of the House, Val Rausch, was at the podium. In just a few minutes, as we indicated, the governor will be here to lay out his proposals. He has not really given anyone a heads up as to what to expect. In previous years, sometimes the governors would have some press conferences to kind of give right. everyone a heads up. So right. as the governor lays out his agenda, we will all be learning it as you hear it and see it today on SDPB.
But stay tuned throughout the entire 35-day legislative session. SDPB will be here the entire time. Top of every hour of radio newscast, you will have the latest of votes and things happening in committees. SDPB TV also having live coverage Tuesday evenings for an hour and a wrap-up every Friday evening. Live coverage of the floor sessions on SDPB 2 will happen in both the House and the Senate chambers every afternoon throughout the session.
And as you mentioned that, Kara, that is something new. We have not done live coverage of the House and Senate for many years. So as lawmakers debate the bills, they talk about their bills, you can watch it as it happens. Again, it's on SDPB2, so you'll have to check your listings to make sure your cable company gets it. And, of course, everything is online at sdpb.org. Just a reminder, as soon as the governor is done today, both Kara and I will be visiting with lawmakers to get their reactions. We'll visit with both Republicans and Democrats. And, of course, the Democrats will probably be laying out their own proposal in the coming days.
Exactly. And we'll find out. We've heard some interesting proposals are already out there. The Game Fish and Parks is going to ask lawmakers to give game wardens authority to arrest boaters who are driving under the influence. Boating under the influence, it's called. So they're asking lawmakers to give game wardens the same authority as if they were driving a vehicle, and they can physically remove them from the boat if they do test positive and arrest them and give them a ticket for boating under the influence. One initiative that's coming.
As we know, in December, the governor laid out his proposal for fiscal year 2013. Some of that did include a raise for state employees, increase in funding of 2.3% with a one-time fund as well. State employees would also get kind of a one-time fund. Now, if that all passes, will be up to this legislature and then whatever finally makes it to the governor's desk. As you know, there are 105 people here that also have their own agenda. So as some of these proposals that the governor laid out in December play themselves out over the next 35 days. We'll watch it. We'll be following it. We'll be bringing you the outcomes as they take place on SDPB Radio. You can listen to the committee hearings live on the Internet as they happen. And, of course, the floor action will be broadcast on SDPB2. And one more reminder, we have a new addition to our State House coverage. Join me every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Central, 6 Mountain, as we do a live talk show. Whatever the hot topic is that week, whatever the bills are that week, we will bring on those individuals that are proposing them, those that have objection to them. We'll bring on the lobbyists. We'll really dive into what the bill is, what it means, what it will do if it does become law. You can email us during the hour if you have a question. That's every Tuesday. It's called State House Live, and it will be a new addition to our coverage here on SDPB.
One other new addition is the SDPB.org legislative webpage. And every day you're going to be able to see what hearings are happening, what bills are being heard, what time they're being heard, where they're being heard. You can listen to it live. You can also bookmark it. You can use it with your calendar. I mean, all kinds of things. And then every story that is written, every story that is produced about that topic is also right there on the legislative webpage as well. Lots of opportunities to know what your lawmakers are doing and what's coming up so you can be a part of the decision as well.
Absolutely. A window into your state house as it takes place this winter. So far, we do know that the bills are up for this year. We're looking at about 57 Senate bills that have been put in the hopper so far, and about 51 House bills, of course, that will increase over the next several weeks. But according to the Legislative Research Council, that is up from last year. Of course, we all know at this time last year, the governor had already made the decision there would be cuts. We know how that played out at the end of the session. The energy is a little bit different this year, and of course, everyone's saying the debate will be whether we stay hold steady and keep things as they are, or will the fight be over what new programs to bring in, maybe what programs to bring back? So we'll be following that, and I'm sure you will too as you listen, go online, and watch from home.
You know, one of the things about the energy level here, Stephanie, is that their lawmakers have told me that they feel that they have an opportunity to introduce new things. Last year it was about cutting. It was about making tough choices. And this year it's all about new initiatives and bringing new things to the state of South Dakota.
All right. And it looks like everyone is taking their seat. We have the Speaker of the House, Val Roush, at the podium. So we'll now go down to the House floor.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, members of the House and Senate. It is my pleasure to introduce and welcome to the podium Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels.
Humbling. Thank you so much. Great to be with you. The joint session will come to order, and leading us in prayer today is Pastor Melhoff from the Peer for Peer Ministerial Association. Is that correct?
St. Mary's in Aberdeen.
St. Mary's in Aberdeen.
Yep. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed your glory to all nations, God of power and might, God of wisdom and justice. Through your authority, their laws are rightly administrated, they're enacted, and judgment is decreed. Assist with your spirit of counsel and fortitude the governor of South Dakota, that his administration may be conducted in righteousness and be eminently useful to your people over whom he presides. May he execute the laws with justice and mercy. Let the light of your divine wisdom direct the deliberations of this legislature and shine forth in all the proceedings and laws framed for our rule and government. May these faithful legislators seek to preserve peace, promote happiness, and continue to bring us the blessings of liberty, morality, and equality. We pray for our judges and elected civil officials and all others who are entrusted to guard our political welfare. May they be enabled by your powerful protection to discharge their duties with honesty and ability. We likewise commend to your mercy all citizens of South Dakota, that we may be blessed in the knowledge and sanctified in the observance of your holy law. May we all be preserved in union and share in the peace that comes from you. And after enjoying the blessings of this life, may we be admitted to eternal life with you. We pray to you, who are Lord and God forever and ever. Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Secretary will call the roll of the Senate.
Adelstein, Begalka, Bradford, Brown, Buell, Cutler, Frerichs, Frisley, Gray, Hansen, Haberly, Heineman, Holeen, Hunstead, Hunhoff, Jean, Johnston, Junkie, Kraus, Krebs, Lederman, Maher, Nelson, Norstrup, Nygaard, Olson, Peters, Putnam, Rampelberg, Rave, Roden, Schleckaway, Sutton, Tiedemann, Thiessen, Valley. Quorum present, Mr. President.
Thank you. Clerk will call the roll of the House of Representatives.
Abdallah Blake, Boland, Boomgarten, Bruner, Carson, Consett, Cronin, Dielstra, Dennert, Dryden, Elliott, Fargen, Feichert, Feinstein, Gibson, Gosch, Greenfield, Hager, Hansen, Hawley, Hickey, Hoffman, Hubbell, Hunhoff, Hunt, Ironcloud, Jensen, Jones, Killer, Kirkaby, Kirschman, Klochek, Kopp, List, Lucas, Lust, Magstad, Miller, Mosher, Munsterman, Nelson, Norstrup, Olson, Perry, Romkema, Roth, Rosam, Russell, Schaefer, Schrempf, Scott, Sigdestad, Sly, Solemn, Steele, Street, Strickers, Tarno, Tulson, Turbeville, Van Gruppen, Vanneman, Benner, Vircio, White, Wick, Wilson, Wink, Wismer, Speaker, Rausch. Mr. President, a quorum is present.
Thank you. Madam Secretary.
Mr. President, Senator Olson moves that a committee of three on the part of the Senate and a committee of four on the part of the House be appointed to escort the Honorable Dennis Dugard, Governor of the State of South Dakota, to the rostrum.
Is there a second? All those in favor of that motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. The President announces a such committee of the Escort Committee from the State Senate, Senators Gray, Russell Olson, and Frerichs. From the South Dakota House of Representatives, Representative Luss, Cronin, Bernie Hunhoff, and Frerichs. Excuse me, Fargen. You know, thank you personally for that kind and humbling applause, but you deserve applause as legislators. We have all walked together in public service. We are stewards of an incredible institution of self-governance, and that's why the governor and I applaud you. I personally am in awe of what's been given to us by God and those who have come before us, and especially those in the service to our armed forces so that we could join as citizens to be free. I'm struck especially today, 90 years ago this week, stood a gentleman right there where Clerk Gerdes stands, who is a gentleman who adopted my mother at age 5 and became my grandfather. 90 years ago, that same week, a gentleman who sat out there where you're sitting was a taxicab driver from Pier, became my wife's grandfather. We are indeed stewards of this time and this process. Today, our son Colin is here, and he has grown up in this great institution, this family of service. First Lady and your family, Karen and Colin and I are incredibly grateful for you and the entire family, including us as part of your family and treating us as family these past few years. It is a tremendous honor. In fact, words cannot articulate the honor it is to serve with and for our governor. And he too has embraced our family, as one of his, and I'm proud to call him a great friend. He's a man of incredible character, phenomenal vision, passion, and compassion. And ladies and gentlemen, we are indeed privileged to have him serve as our governor. It is with great honor that our esteemed Sergeant-at-Arms, Mr. Mel Chandler, please announce the arrival of the governor of the state of South Dakota.
Lieutenant Governor and members of the legislature, the Honorable Governor of the state of South Dakota, Dennis Dugard.
Thank you very much. Before we begin, just moments ago, I learned through Russ Janklow that Governor Janklow has been moved into hospice care. And so I want all of us to remember his great service to our state and all he did for us, and ask that you keep his family and him in your prayers. Thank you very much for allowing me to serve you this past year. It was 1 year ago today that I walked into my office for the first work day as governor, and it's been an honor every day since then to serve this great state. I'm also honored to work and serve with the public servants gathered here today. And there's one I'd like to particularly mention today. Moments ago, we heard a familiar voice announce my arrival in this chamber. We've heard this same voice now for over 20 years, the House Sergeant-at-Arms, Mel Chandler, and this will be Mel's last year working for the legislature, and I want to thank him for his years of service to our state. Will you help me, Mel? Now, Mel, you still have to work this session. Still have to, okay. It is my duty and pleasure today to report to you on the state of the state. And I'm pleased to say South Dakota and her condition has improved since we last met at this time last year. South Dakota is moving forward. It's not the best of times, but neither is it the worst of times. And we have reason to be hopeful. Today, because of tough budget decisions you made, our state is on stronger financial footings. And because of the hard work of the people of South Dakota, our economy is also stronger, in spite of what may happen in Wall Street or Washington, D.C. Our unemployment rate is lower, and non-farm employment numbers are increasing. But we have not yet returned those numbers to pre-recession levels, and there is still great uncertainty. We are recovering, but we have not yet fully recovered. That is why last month I proposed a conservative budget that departs from freezes and cuts and returns to formula increases, but still guards against a downturn. My budget spends 99% of the revenues we project to receive, but still leaves money on the bottom line against uncertainties in case we need it. Beyond economic progress, we've made efforts in other areas as well. Last year, in my first State of the State address, I spoke to you about the problem of infant mortality in South Dakota. Every year, on average, 80 infants die in South Dakota before their first birthday. The infant mortality rate is one of the most important measures of a population's health, and we can do better. Consequently, I convened a 27-member task force led by our First Lady to recommend ways to address this problem. The task force identified four key improvement opportunities. First, we need to ensure access to early and regular prenatal care, which is vital to a healthy pregnancy. Second, too many South Dakota mothers smoke during pregnancy, which puts the health of an infant at risk. Third, safe sleep practices, like having a baby sleep on its back in a crib without loose blankets. That makes a difference. And fourth, we need to address these disparities within Native American populations. You'll be hearing more in the coming months about these efforts, but today I can announce we'll use available funds to expand the Bright Start home visiting program. Bright Start's a voluntary program under which specially trained nurses visit high-risk pregnant women in their homes. My budget proposes to expand Bright Start to four new communities, beginning with Pine Ridge and Sisseton. In addition, the state will be redoubling efforts to educate new parents on safe sleep practices, and we will use existing funds for tobacco control to educate the public about the dangers of tobacco use during pregnancy. I'd encourage you all to review the task force's report, and I know Linda will be presenting to both health committees this week. I want to thank Linda, or about this work sometime, and I want to thank Linda and the entire task force for their commitment and time, and I sincerely hope their efforts will help more South Dakota children live to see their first birthday. Another task force that worked hard this year was the Medicaid Solutions Work Group. We all recognize the challenge that Medicaid poses to our state budget. Medicaid is second only to education as a portion of our general fund budget, and we face increasing enrollments, increasing costs of those enrolled, and falling federal support of Medicaid as our personal income growth is stronger than the nation's. I formed the Medicaid Solutions Work Group during the last legislative session to see what we could do to control the growth of this expenditure category. Legislators, healthcare providers from around the state, my staff, others interested in Medicaid all participated, over 80 people in all. And the task force continued to meet through the session and into the rest of this year. The task force issued its report last month. What they found was that South Dakota's Medicaid program, first of all, is an efficient and conservative program. We have never had many of the expensive options that now burden other states. And there are not many things, consequently, that we could cut. The group focused instead on key cost drivers in Medicaid, care for people with chronic conditions, high-cost services like neonatal care for premature babies, prescription drugs, institutional services, and emergency room use. After much research and discussion, the work group developed a dozen key recommendations. Two of these recommendations have a direct impact on the budget I propose for FY13. The Department of Social Services budget includes a reduction of about $340,000 in general funds as a result of increasing co-payments for prescription drugs and implementing an annual cap on dental services for adults. Other recommendations will take longer to accomplish. Proposals to manage care differently for those with chronic conditions and to help people stay in their homes longer or in their communities longer to avoid higher cost services. The work group's recommendations provide solutions that make sense for South Dakota, and I appreciate the efforts of everyone who's participated. I especially want to thank Senators Cory Brown, Jason Frerichs, Gene Hunhoff, Deb Peters and Bruce Rampelberg, as well as Representatives Susie Blake, Justin Cronin, and Scott Munsterman for their efforts on the task force. This year, we've also seen and addressed the severe mountain pine beetle epidemic in the Black Hills, which has left large swaths of dead trees in its wake. Over 400,000 acres in the Black Hills forest land are infested with this pest, which has spread from federal land onto state land and private property. As a result, the potential for massive forest fires is very high. Through the Black Hills Forest Initiative, state crews working with private landowners are taking on this threat by identifying and marking tens of thousands of beetle-infested trees and providing 50% cost share for their removal. The response of the program has been huge, in fact, over double what we anticipated, and it has encouraged local governments as well to participate in other cost-sharing arrangements. In addition, state staff, private contractors, and inmate crews are working to address this infestation in Custer State Park and other state lands. Of 142,000 identified trees that are infested, more than 30,000 have already been cut down. All 142,000 trees are scheduled to be cut down by March 30th. Further activities will recommence next fall. The pine beetle epidemic remains a grave threat to the Black Hills, but our continuing efforts will slow the spread of that epidemic. This summer, I also announced a Better Government initiative, an ongoing focus on making state government more open, more efficient, and more accessible. I asked my cabinet to conduct a red tape review to eliminate regulations or statutes that are out of date or unnecessary, and to simplify those that are too complex. I'm proud to say that they exceeded my expectations in this first year. We will be bringing 22 bills, totaling 168 pages in length, to repeal unnecessary regulations and statutes. Through these bills, as well as through the rules process, we will propose eliminating nearly 1,100 rules and 200,000 words from the administrative rules of South Dakota. Additionally, we'll recommend the repeal of over 400 sections of codified law. This is the first year of our effort, but it won't be the last. And I hope, as legislators, you will exert your own effort toward reducing the numbers of laws and regulations which burden our citizens, equal to the effort that you exert toward initiating new ones. My administration has also sought to make government more open and transparent. We've released the list for the governor's hunt and other economic development events. We've also made public the names of those who sponsor those events. We've opened the governor's mansion in Valhalla to public tours, regular tours, for the first time in our state's history. We've released more information from the Department of Corrections. We've made the governor's Office of Economic Development more open than ever before. In fact, every recipient of a state economic development loan or award administered by GOED is now available for viewing online. Finally, we've added more functionality and more information to opensd.gov and created a better search function to the state homepage. If you haven't visited the state homepage in recent months, I encourage you to do that. I think you'll be pleased with what you find. Finally, we've made great strides toward allowing our citizens to go online rather than wait in line to interact with their state governments. I'm proud to announce today that more than 20 permits and licenses can be obtained fully online for the first time, and that many more have been identified for this upgrade. This saves time and effort for our state workers, and again, we are just beginning this effort, which will be ongoing. Of course, my top priority of the past year has been creating jobs and growing the economy, and I'm proud of the progress we've made this past year. We've added more than 5,000 jobs in the last 2 years, and the number of jobs in South Dakota has nearly reached its pre-recession peak. Our unemployment rate, which has been among the three lowest in the nation, has fallen again to 4.3%. When I started my term as governor, I asked the governor's Office of Economic Development to redouble their effort and their emphasis on economic development efforts for businesses already here in South Dakota. The statistics show, and I truly believe, that South Dakota's most important job creators are the entrepreneurs and businesses that are already in South Dakota. In 2011, the Office of Economic Development assisted 61 companies with expansions through financing or technical assistance. Of those, 73% are existing South Dakota companies. So they are doing as I had asked. I also want to listen to South Dakota business. Since I took office, Lieutenant Governor and I and the GOED staff have visited more than 250 existing South Dakota businesses to encourage them to grow and expand in South Dakota and to listen. We ask them to tell us, how can the state help you be better, be bigger, have more jobs? We've seen that business are expanding and adding workers all over South Dakota. In Watertown, OEM Worldwide is undergoing an $11 million expansion that will add 150 jobs. In Spearfish, TM1 has opened an office that's already created 60 jobs and expects to add more. Adams Thermal Systems in Canton is adding 50 jobs as part of its fifth expansion in Canton since 2005. We've seen job announcements in Madison, Yankton, Sturgis, Mitchell, Vermilion, Rapid City, and other places. And there's also been good news in the financial services industry. When the federal credit card regulation scheme changed, and that caused job losses in this industry, many of us feared that we'd never get those jobs back. But we are seeing promising signs. This fall, Capital One acquired the HSBC credit card business and announced they would not only retain the 400 jobs there in Sioux Falls, but add 400 more. They've already begun hiring at a pace of 50 a month, 50 a month, and then 100 a month, 100 a month, and plan to fill all jobs before summer. Even as the national economy continues to struggle, South Dakota is bouncing back because of our strong business climate in South Dakota. The Small Business and Entrepreneurship Council ranks South Dakota number one in its Small Business Survival Index. The Tax Foundation ranks South Dakota number one for our state business tax climate. And we continue to have the lowest per capita tax burden in the nation. I have to tell you, I attended the Western Governors Association meeting in California last month, and Pat Costello went with me. We stayed an extra day and a half and met with business leaders in Southern California about opportunities in South Dakota. We put together a slide presentation that compared South Dakota's business and tax climate to California's. And it almost felt unfair. It was like shooting fish in a barrel. California has taxes we've never even heard of. And like many states, they're looking to raise them again. We are lucky to live in South Dakota, where we still understand the role of government and the importance of a balanced budget. Over the past year, we've moved South Dakota forward in these and many other areas. Many, many, too many to recite today. I want to thank my cabinet, my staff, and all others who helped achieve these successes and for your support to make them possible. I'd like to spend the rest of my time now to talk about two important issues that we must address in order to keep South Dakota moving forward. The first of these issues is workforce, and the second issue is teaching. First, let's talk about workforce. I mentioned a moment ago that I've been visiting existing South Dakota businesses to encourage them to expand here in South Dakota. I've heard good news on these visits. Many South Dakota companies have expansion plans. They appreciate our business climate because they don't face the barriers to growth they see in other states. And many of these businesses are in multiple states, so they have a basis for comparison. But I did hear about one major barrier we need to address. One of my visits was to Raven Industries, a technology firm that employs more than 1,000 people in our state. Business is good at Raven, and in 2011, they added 200 jobs in Huron, Madison, and Sioux Falls. They told me they're planning to add another 100 jobs in engineering and other skilled fields. I was excited about what that meant for South Dakota, until they told me they were planning to add those 100 jobs in Texas. They didn't believe they could find another 100 engineers in South Dakota. I've heard similar concerns from other South Dakota employers about the difficulty of finding skilled workers, and the numbers bear them out. Our Department of Labor and Regulation has nearly 10,000 job openings in our employment system. Many of these job openings are for skilled or professional positions, welders, engineers, accountants, jobs like that. Meanwhile, fewer than 100 welders, engineers, IT specialists, accountants are receiving unemployment benefits in South Dakota today. This is a significant barrier to employers who want to expand in South Dakota. We have incredible professionals and technicians, but we need more of them. We need more of them. South Dakota is better positioned in terms of our climate than almost any other state in the nation. But we must do more to address our workforce challenges. So today I'm proposing an effort we're calling South Dakota Wins, short for South Dakota Workforce Initiatives. South Dakota Wins is a 20-point plan grouped into four categories to get more South Dakotans trained and ready to work in a rapidly growing and changing South Dakota economy. The first category involves preparing our children. South Dakota wins when our students are prepared to compete in a modern, high-tech economy. It's hard to overstate the importance of science, technology, engineering, and math in this modern economy. Nearly every high-need career field relies on a strong foundation in these areas. The first component of South Dakota Wins emphasizes science and math education by rewarding math and science teachers for teaching in this high-demand field. This is very important because nothing lights a spark better than an effective and outstanding teacher. I'll speak more about that in a minute. We also want to provide opportunities to inspire future scientists and engineers outside the classroom. Hundreds of South Dakota students have experienced scrub camps organized by our State Department of Health. Scrub camps are free, one-day, hands-on health career camps for high school students. Scrub camps successfully introduce challenges to students in incredibly important medical fields. Our experience has shown that students participating in these camps are highly likely to pursue careers in medicine and other health fields. We need to expand the scrubs camps concept into engineering camps, technical camps, and math camps. The scientists, engineers, nurses, and doctors of tomorrow are already in our K-12 system. Tonight, as they go to bed, they may not understand the value and importance of math and science, but over the next few years, we'll use the tools at our disposal, in and out of the classroom, to show them the possibilities. There's more elements in that first category, but I ask you to look at the plan later. I'm going to move on to the second category. The second category involves training for skilled jobs. South Dakota wins when our workforce is qualified and prepared for all types of careers. An economy needs more than engineers and doctors to flourish. We need skilled and trained technicians who know how to make things. We need more training for those skilled jobs. Our technical institutes provide graduates that our state needs, and I want to see technical education in South Dakota expand. Our state doesn't have enough welders, for example. We need a new welding program at Mitchell Tech, and we're going to work to provide that. We also need to develop hybrid courses so people who are located outside the communities served by a tech school can still get that kind of training, to deliver that training online and in the lab. Likewise, we need to expand the welding program in our corrections facility at Springfield, and the plan includes an effort to do that. I'm also proposing next year that more than 2,000 of our high school students take the National Career Readiness Certificate test. The NCRC is a national certification program used to determine if workers have the skills to succeed in this modern economy. Promoting this certification will help our students demonstrate that they have the job skills to make them good employees, whether they continue their education or go right into the workforce. I'm also reallocating almost $1 million a year in community development block grant funds toward workforce training. Over the years, CDBG dollars have had a tremendous impact on South Dakota, helping to build fire halls, waste and drinking water systems, and community centers. And we'll continue to do that. But CDBG funds will continue to help us do that. At the same time, it is also allowing for training dollar match programs in communities where they want to undertake training of that sort. The third category of our workforce initiative is to promote healthcare occupations, especially in rural areas. South Dakota wins when every citizen of our state, no matter where they live, has access to quality healthcare. Across our state, we have rural communities working hard to succeed, and quality healthcare is vital to those communities. But in rural areas, 59 of South Dakota's 66 counties are medically underserved. 59 of our 66 counties are medically underserved. This is a workforce issue because to have quality health care, you have to have quality health care professionals. The third component of South Dakota WINS improves access to rural health care. Now, primary care is the care a patient receives at the first contact with the health care system. Nationally and in South Dakota, more young doctors, nurse practitioners, physician's assistants, they're choosing to practice as specialists in dermatology, radiology, and other specialties instead of in primary care, instead of in fields like pediatrics or obstetrics or family medicine or internal medicine. We need more primary care providers, and we especially need more primary care providers in rural South Dakota. We need to train more doctors at our medical school, and we need to put programs in place to keep those doctors in South Dakota and to encourage them to choose primary care practice in rural areas of our state. As one point in this category, I support expanding the medical school by 4 additional students per year beginning this year. I also support exposing more medical students to rural practice as part of their third year in medical school. Now, a majority of physicians who attend medical school in South Dakota and who enter a residency program in South Dakota stay in South Dakota to practice medicine. And I want to work with the major health systems, communities, and others to determine the feasibility of creating additional residencies in South Dakota so we don't train our medical students in South Dakota, have them go to residencies in another state, and never come back. In addition to doctors, mid-level professionals like physician's assistants and nurse practitioners also play a critical role in rural health care. As a second point in this category, I'm proposing that we expand the physician's assistant program at USD to double the number of available spots for in-state students. Over the last few years, we've also seen some success in the recruitment and retention of rural health care providers. Our tuition reimbursement program for physicians, dentists, and mid-level providers is working. 31 contracts have been created under those programs, and today, 22 of those professionals are still practicing in their rural communities. Philip, Belfouche, Hot Springs, Howard, Scotland, Flandreau, Mobridge, Gettysburg, Wagner, and 21 other communities have participated in this program, and it is improving health care in rural South Dakota. I am calling for an expansion of the tuition reimbursement program. We also have had a program to help healthcare facilities recruit nurses, lab techs, and other professionals through a signing bonus-like arrangement. Nursing homes and hospitals in rural South Dakota has told us they need to be able to offer greater incentives to these folks to get them to come. We will be introducing legislation to expand this program by providing a higher payment incentive for nurses and other high-need providers at rural facilities. The fourth category of South Dakota WINS, of our workforce initiative, involves recruiting workers to South Dakota. South Dakota WINS when our working population grows by welcoming new skilled workers and encouraging the return of those who have left. Despite aggressive efforts in the classroom and at the tech schools, in the medical arena, the efforts I've described won't be enough to meet our workforce needs. There are 1,466 unfilled jobs in this state in the engineering, information technology, accounting, and skilled worker fields today. All our training programs are for tomorrow. There are fewer than 100 South Dakota workers today in those careers receiving unemployment benefits. So the fourth category of South Dakota WINS brings professional and skilled workers into our state to fill this gap. The Dakota Roots program you heard of, I know, brings South Dakota, former South Dakotans, back home by matching them with job opportunities in this state. And Dakota Roots has helped more than 2,000 families relocate to South Dakota. By expanding the outreach and aggressiveness of that program and by targeting areas of highest need, we're going to bring even more South Dakotans back home. But we won't stop there. As skilled workers in other states face continued high unemployment and an uncertain future, South Dakota can offer them better. We can be their land of opportunity. Last year at the state fair, my family received the Century Farm Award. It was in 1911 that my grandparents, Martin and Margaret Dugard, bought our family farm. They came from Denmark, hoping to find a better life for themselves in South Dakota. They knew South Dakota offered them a chance, and they sought nothing more than that. My grandparents worked as hard as people can work, and together they built a life in this state. Many of you have similar stories about your families. Today, as in the past, South Dakota offers something special for those that value community and hard work and family. Have we done enough in recent years to share that story? Do those that share our values but live elsewhere know what we have to offer? Do they realize that South Dakota can be their land of opportunity? The time has come for us to be aggressive in selling South Dakota, not just to companies that want to move here, but also to skilled workers and families that can make our companies and our communities more successful. Today, I'm announcing an innovative and first-of-its-kind relationship to attract a new generation of skilled pioneers to our state. The New South Dakotans Initiative will partner state government with South Dakota businesses and with Manpower, the world's largest workforce recruiter. Together, we will work to identify and place 1,000 professional and skilled workers from outside of our state into jobs here in South Dakota. As we move forward with this proposal, we'll protect qualified South Dakota workers. The program will focus on high-demand jobs in industries without enough in-state professionals to fill them. In fact, no job will be listed with the program until it's been in our state system for at least 30 days, giving our state citizens first shot at those jobs. Now, in the gallery, we have some of the employers who are interested in expanding their businesses, and they're excited about participating in the new South Dakotans program. One of the companies here is Raven Industries, whose difficulty in hiring engineers brought this challenge into focus for me. Now Raven is among the first companies to enroll in the new South Dakotans program. We also have representatives here from Molded Fiberglass in Aberdeen, Applied Engineering in Yankton, and RPM in Rapid City. And those companies have also express an interest in participating. They're here in the gallery to my right. Let's welcome them to the Capitol. There are also representatives here from Manpower. Although they have thousands of offices around the world, we'll be working with their South Dakota-based team, people who know and love our state and who have chosen to make South Dakota their home. Now let's think about the impact of 1,000 new South Dakotans. The impact of 1,000 new welders and engineers and machinists and accountants on our state's economy will be enormous. Those 1,000 families will add more than $120 million to our gross state product, put hundreds of children into our schools, and pay millions of dollars in state taxes. Between 1930 and 1990, I'll say that again, between 1930 and 1990, the population in our state changed up and down and ended up 3,000 more than 1930. 3,000 in 1990 more than in 1930. The Dakota Roots program and the New South Dakotans program will give us the opportunity to replicate that population growth, not over 60 years, but only in a few. Recent decades have seen South Dakota grow, and I'm dedicated to continue that growth through smart investment and innovative approaches. Now, there are 20 different ideas in South Dakota Wins, and all of them can be found online at www.SouthDakotaWins, not SD Wins, SouthDakotaWins, spelled out, .com. To be successful, we must join together with workers, communities, schools, and businesses, and I'm committing to do just that. Although the plan is ambitious, the investment required is relatively modest compared to what the impact will be. With our efforts, we can begin to transform our workforce, and with it, our state. We can light the spark that creates future scientists and engineers, and we can train workers to fill jobs they want and need. We can reinvest in our rural health care system. We can welcome back home the young people who've left, and we can recruit professionals and skilled technicians who seek a better land of opportunity. We can do those things, and we must do them if we want to move our state forward. Thank you. Now that you've heard some of my suggestions for improving our workforce, I'd like to talk to you about investing in teaching. Of course, the best way to build a skilled workforce in South Dakota is to provide a quality education to our young people. As I said in my State of the State address last year, the foundation of our economy is an educated workforce. And I'm proud of South Dakota schools. I'm proud of them. Our students' test scores, our ACT scores, and our NAEP scores, our National Assessment of Educational Progress, those scores, they routinely exceed national averages. They always do. Our high school graduation rate is strong, much better than most places. And our high school graduates go on to post-secondary education at one of the highest rates in the nation. We have much to be proud about in South Dakota in our education system. Our schools do well because we have involved parents, we have talented and hardworking students, and very dedicated teachers and administrators. My wife Linda spent much of her adult life working as a teacher and a school librarian. In the past year, she's visited over 90 elementary schools to promote reading, and she's been impressed by the teachers and principals she's met. But we need to do more to reward our best teachers for the work they do and to attract more of our talented young people into the teaching profession. That's why today I'm pleased to announce the South Dakota Investing in Teachers Initiative. Let's begin, though, with some historical perspective. I graduated from high school 40 years ago, 1971. I asked my staff to look back and see what's happened in education since then. In 1971, South Dakota had 173,006 students, 8,452 certified teachers, and another 5,436 non-teachers, other staff. Everything from administrators and aides to cooks and janitors in other staff. 40 years later, there were 123,629 students in K-12. That's a decline of just under 50,000 students in 40 years, a drop of about 28%. During that same period, while student numbers were falling, we've added 869 new teachers. Today we have more than 9,300 teachers, an increase of about 10%. So we're employing over 800 more teachers to educate 50,000 fewer students. We've also seen a more dramatic shift in other staff over the past 40 years. From the 5,436 in 1971, we've increased to 9,005. That's an increase of 3,569, or 66%. Today we have over 9,300 teachers and just over 9,000 other staff, We employ as many non-teachers, nearly as many non-teachers as teachers. Here's a look at that same data over time in a graphical form. The blue line is the number of students from 1971 to 2011 with a scale on the left. The red line shows teachers, and the green line shows other staff. The scale for the teachers and other staff is on the right. Now, there's a three-year gap in the data for other staff. That's why there's a missing spot in the line. But the trends are very clear. During the 1970s, there was a dramatic decline in students, but very little corresponding consistent change in staffing. Beginning in the 1990s, there's been a significant increase in other staff. When you combine teaching and other staff, we employ nearly twice as many employees per student today than when I graduated from high school in 1971. Why did that happen? I know some of this increase in staff is due to the integration of special education students into public school classrooms. But the federal law that created that movement happened in 1975. Look at the teaching and other staff from 1975 forward. Not much happened until 1990. Other government mandates maybe have contributed. I don't know. Looking at this data, I would guess that some of this increase is just due to the tendency of institutions, including government-sponsored school, to grow larger over time. Let's look at some other history. We need to understand these trends as we discuss education in our state. Another way to measure our efforts in education is through looking at spending. The National Center for Education Statistics, a part of the U.S. Department of Education, compiles data on education spending per pupil. Doesn't matter whether it's come from the federal government, comes from local government, comes from state government, but let's look and see what's being spent. In inflation-adjusted dollars, Now, I don't have the data for every year, but it's available on the internet. Here's what it shows. In 1969, in inflation-adjusted dollars, we're using 2009 dollars, South Dakota spent $3,920 per student. Now, really, we spent less than $1,000, but I'm inflating it to 2009 dollars, okay? That's $3,920 in 2009 inflation-adjusted dollars. In the most recent year available, 2008, South Dakota spent $9,173 per student, again in 2009 inflation-adjusted dollars. Now, I grant that 2008 is before our budget required a freeze and a cut. But take 10% off that, and you're still spending more than twice as much as you spent per student in 1971, or 69 rather. In the 39-year period from 1969 to 2008, in constant inflation-adjusted dollars, our per-student spending on education more than doubled. We spent 2.3 times more per student. So that's the trend over the last four decades. We have 50,000 fewer students. We have added more than 800 teachers, 3,500 other staff. We're employing nearly twice as many staff per student. And we're spending well over twice per student in inflation-adjusted dollars than we spent when we looked at the beginning. Is that wrong? No. One can often do a job better or faster or more effectively when you apply more resources to it. Any job can be done better or more effectively or faster if you apply more resources to it. Whether it's human resources or money. And as I've said often in the past, we should measure our success in education not by what we're putting into it. We should measure it by what we're getting out of it. Results. We all know that our schools perform well, but given the statistics I've just shared, we should expect to see significant improvement in performance over time. Is that the case? Unfortunately, it's not. It is not. Our schools do well, and our test scores are good, but they have flatlined. they have flatlined. Our ACT scores, our NAEP scores, and our graduation rates are above the national average, but they've been relatively unchanged for decades. I asked the Department of Education to compile our average ATC scores over the past four decades. Here's what we found. The red line on this chart shows the average score from 1971 to 1985. Now, after 85, the test was revised, so you can't compare the beginning of the chart on the far left to the far right. You look at the trend in the red and the trend in the blue. But as you can see, there's only variation from year to year with no significant upward or downward trends. In the 26 years since the test changed in 1986, that would be those years represented by the blue line, the average has stayed within 1 point, from a low of 21 to a high of 22. We see a similar trend in the NAEP, the National Assessment of Educational Progress. We don't have nearly as long a period to look at, but this is a test that our fourth graders and eighth graders have taken in math and reading since 2003 to comply with No Child Left Behind. It's the same test they take nationwide, the same test. The data doesn't go back 4 years, but since 2003, we've seen very little movement in these scores either. The chart shows the scores in eighth grade math in blue, eighth grade reading in red, fourth grade math in green, fourth grade reading in purple. On a 500-point scale, each of these scores has varied by 5 points or less over five testing cycles, and it's a variation of less than 1%. So less than 1% change. Now, what's more troubling than that is, even though our NAEP scores are steady and we're doing well, we're better than the national average, we're being passed up by other states. In 2003, only four states exceeded our score for fourth grade reading. Now 20 states are better than us. Only eight states exceeded our fourth grade score in math in 2003. Now 18 states are better than South Dakota. We've seen a similar pattern in the eighth grade scores too. Other states are passing us by. I'm showing you all this not because I want to be critical of our schools or the jobs they're doing. We have good schools. We are routinely above the national average in each of these indicators. But remember, our staffing levels and our spending levels have gone up significantly. A sizable increase in our investment in education over time is not getting us better achievement. We're simply putting more money into the same system, and we're not getting better results. We need to change our focus. The key to obtaining high achievement in the classroom is not more spending, it is effective teachers. Let me say that again. The key to obtaining high achievement for our students is great teachers. I recently met with officials from the Bush Foundation, and they shared a study with me from Tennessee. This study looked at a group of children entering the third grade and followed them through the end of fifth grade. So all of third, fourth, and fifth grades, 3 years. Both groups began the third grade at the 50th percentile. They're average. Both of them were right on the average. One group of students had high-performing teachers each year, teachers in the top 20% of their peer group. The other class had low-performing teachers from the bottom 20% for three straight years. After these 3 years, the students with the high-performing teachers were in the 90th percentile, up from the 50th percentile. The students with the low-performing teachers had dropped to the 37th percentile. There was a 53-point difference. That's a dramatic result, but it just confirms common sense, doesn't it? South Dakota needs to focus on investing in teachers. Our goal in South Dakota is to increase student achievement, and our focus must be on attracting and retaining great teachers. We need clear standards, rigorous measurement, and rewards for excellence. Some of the pieces of investing in teachers are already being put into place. You've heard about them. South Dakota is adopting the Common Core Standards. And these standards are not just a list of what concepts to teach. They're a new approach to teaching based on problem-solving and higher-order thinking skills. They're evidence-based. In the budget address, I announced an aggressive training program for our teachers to learn the Common Core standards and these new techniques. A second important component is our new school accountability system. Earlier this year, our state announced that we would no longer comply with No Child Left Behind, which is a broken and flawed system. Instead, we are seeking a waiver from No Child Left Behind, which will allow us to create a measurement and accountability system that makes sense for South Dakota. When fully implemented, this system will not just test students at the end of the year and measure them against an arbitrary bar. Instead, we will test students at the beginning of the year, in the middle of the year, and again at the end of the year. In the middle of the year, our tests will allow for mid-course corrections, so instructors can see where the children are lacking and where they're already strong. At the end of the year, we'll be able to measure the difference between the beginning and the end and see what growth has occurred, not whether the children have moved up to some arbitrary bar. In one class, they might start down here and move a long way, but still below that arbitrary bar. In another class, they might start very close and move up a little bit, and this teacher is presumed to be excellent. Growth is what we should measure. Growth from beginning to the end and what the teacher has driven should be measured. Another important component that is already being finalized is a better teacher evaluation system. The system we are creating will consider growth in test scores as an important component, but it'll also include classroom evaluation based upon observation of evidence-based factors. In addition, it'll give local schools flexibility to consider additional factors. And this is the groundwork for a strong system based on standards that define great teaching. And another portion of the training program, announced last month, will train administrators in these evaluation strategies. You need to have teachers doing their best work against these standards and administrators capable of evaluating them accurately and fairly. So, we're training teachers in new teaching methods. We're creating a new school accountability system with better testing. And we're implementing a stronger teacher evaluation system. These steps will be implemented over the next 3 years. When they are completely in place, these pieces will allow us to reward our best teachers. Beginning in the 2014-15 school year, we will ask schools to identify their very best teachers, the top 20% in each district, based upon the new evaluation system. Under the Investing in Teachers initiative, the state will give every teacher in the top 20% a bonus of $5,000. Every teacher is eligible. The bonuses will not go into base salaries, but they can be earned every year by a teacher who remains in the top 20%. In addition, I mentioned earlier the importance of math and science education to our future workforce needs. We have to recognize the importance of having excellent math and science teachers because they light the spark that ignites a generation of engineers, doctors, and scientists. We need to attract our best teaching students into the fields of math and science, and we need more teachers in these fields especially. Listen to some numbers. In the 2009-2010 school year, our state universities graduated 176 new elementary school teachers. 176 new elementary school teachers. They graduated 24 math teachers, 13 biology teachers, and two chemistry teachers. Not only do we not train enough new teachers, we also face greater outside competition from the private sector for the math and science teachers we already have. For the same reason that math and science are important skills for our students, teachers with training in those areas have more opportunities to leave teaching for other careers. I've heard stories, and most superintendents will confirm this, about school districts that get dozens of applicants for an elementary school opening. Dozens. But they're lucky to get even one qualified applicant for a position as a math or a science teacher in high school. This is a real problem, and the free market can help us. The way to retain our math and science teachers and to attract more young people into these fields is to apply free market principles. We simply can't expect students to enter these challenging fields and to remain in them if they're not rewarded any differently than any other teacher. Beginning in the 2013-14 year, I propose the state pay every middle school and high school math or science teacher a bonus of $3,500. Not into their base salary, but a teacher who stays in this field will qualify for the $3,500 bonus every year. So I'm proposing two bonus programs, a $5,000 bonus for the top 20% of teachers and a $3,500 bonus for math and science teachers. And a teacher can qualify for both bonuses. That means if a math or science teacher is in the top 20% of the teachers in his or her district, they would receive a bonus of $8,500 on top of their base salary. For a teacher earning a salary of about $3,500, that's a bonus of about 25%. Funding these bonuses is a sizable obligation, and I want to emphasize my strong commitment to fully funding these incentive payments every year, not just one time, but every year. These bonuses will be paid entirely with state dollars, and they will be in addition to the annual formula funding increases. This is a three-year plan. This year, I've already proposed $8 million in one-time funds for aggressive training on the Common Core standards and on teacher and administrator training. Next year, I'll propose adding $5 million in ongoing funds on top of the formula to fund the bonuses for math and science teachers. And the year after that, I'll propose another $10 million in ongoing funds on top of the formula and on top of the $5 million to fund the incentive bonuses for our best teachers. This is by far the largest investment in the teaching profession in the history of our state. I am proposing one more change as part of this package. It has to do with teacher tenure. Investing in teachers makes a significant investment to reward our best teachers and to attract more talented people into teaching. But even as we reward our best teachers, we need to give administrators fair and objective tools to measure performance to deal with the few teachers who just aren't able to perform in their jobs. Teachers who currently have tenure will not lose it under my proposal. Let me repeat that. No teacher who has currently tenure will lose it under my proposal. But I am proposing that South Dakota end the availability of tenure effective July 1 of this year for anyone who doesn't have it by that date. We're moving away from a system that relies on tenure and into a system that's based on rigorous, evidence-based evaluation. New teachers can be confident that administrators are conducting professional evaluations and basing decisions on facts and proven methods. Administrators will have a strong foundation to make informed decisions about their teaching force, and they'll have the flexibility to carry out those informed decisions. In every field, people want to strive for something better. They want to achieve more through hard work. Many of our teachers go the extra mile, but most of them are still paid based on how long they've worked there or whether they have a master's degree or not. A $5,000 bonus is a way to demonstrate to our top teachers that we want to compensate for results, not seniority. Results. And we appreciate the work they do, and we reward them for their service to our young people. By investing in great teachers, we are investing in our young people and in South Dakota. That is my vision for education in South Dakota. We are not afraid to invest in our young people, but we cannot fall into the trap of believing that more money automatically creates better results. We've seen it does not. We cannot simply pour more money into the same old system. Rather, we must focus on improving results and spend creatively and strategically to achieve results. The key to high achievement is great teaching. And we will invest the dollars that it will take to make a difference. So this is the state of our state. We have great opportunities this year to move our state forward. Now that we're on a sound financial footing, we can build a stronger South Dakota. We can budget carefully and protect against uncertainty. We can strengthen our state's workforce through a package of proposals to train South Dakotans and attract more people to South Dakota. And we can strengthen our education system by rewarding great teaching with a special emphasis on math and science. These are not small proposals, and they'll require hard work from all of us. But it's only because of your courage and hard work last year that we are in a position to consider proposals like this for this year and 2 years more. I'm confident we'll be successful because of what we all saw in South Dakota this spring. And I'd like to close today by talking about what we saw in South Dakota last spring. We're used to natural disasters in South Dakota. We have tornadoes, blizzards, wildfires, droughts. We've had our share of flooding in the past year. And in some parts of our state, flooding happens too often. But the flooding we experienced along the Missouri River this spring was different. It was very different. We've never been given 2 weeks' notice that a disaster was coming. It was a Wednesday night in late May when the Corps of Engineers called to alert us that their releases would be much higher than planned. And South Dakota sprang to action. In Dakota Dunes, in Yankton, in Pierre and Fort Pierre, up and down the Missouri River, South Dakotans stepped up. Homeowners packed up and moved their possessions and built massive sandbag walls. Contractors worked with feverish activity to build emergency levees, compressing months of work into days. Truck drivers and heavy construction crews came from hundreds of miles and worked around the clock to hasten the construction. Law enforcement controlled traffic at every intersection to speed the work. Prison inmates, homeowners, and neighbors filled sandbags, millions of sandbags. National Guard troops aided with preparations and patrolled the levees all summer, all day, and all night. State employees manned the Emergency Operations Center for nearly a month. And thousands of volunteers poured into the affected communities to help. They came from every corner. I met a group of Boy Scouts who dropped their plans for a Black Hills camping trip to help. I saw college basketball teams, football teams, and volleyball teams by the busload coming to help. Groups of Hutterites. I saw boxes and supplies from all across South Dakota sent to help those affected. I saw friends and neighbors do back-breaking work hauling sandbags for hours and hours to secure private homes. I've never been prouder of South Dakota than I was during those weeks. It was a time that exemplified our values of persistence, hard work, determination, perseverance. No one thought about politics or the next election. No one got distracted by petty squabbling. No one took a poll or kept a scorecard. South Dakotans were faced with a challenge, and we all rolled up our sleeves, and we overcame it. Together, we overcame it. As high as the floodwaters rose, South Dakota rose even higher. I call on all of us now to continue in that same spirit as we move forward this legislative session. If we do, there is no limit to how high South Dakota can climb.
And that will wrap up the State of the State address delivered by Governor Dennis Dugard for the 87th South Dakota Legislative Session. Stay with us. We're going to have some reaction interviews. My colleague Kara Hetland is on the floor of the House of Representatives. She'll visit with some lawmakers as others will come up here. Some interesting things came out of the governor's address today. We will see South Dakota wins. It will be a workforce initiative where he will target some of those health care jobs. There are many counties, particularly rural counties in South Dakota, that are underserved. This administration, part of the initiative, will create more individuals in the health care workforce. There will be incentives for those, not just at the doctor level, but some of those mid-level positions, our pharmaceutical area, our physicians, our techs, those types of jobs. Education was also heavily talked about in the governor's speech. He will be rolling out some ideas to change the way our teachers are evaluated, to change the way our students are tested. Those standards, they'll be tested at the beginning, the middle, and the end of the session, all in hopes of keeping our children highly educated and able to enter into the workforce. One of the things that the governor talked about, it's not how much you put into something, it's what comes out of what you put into it, and he was directly referring to education. Lots of things talked about today, of course, the very end. The governor talked about the great flood of the Missouri River that impacted South Dakota, how proud he was those weeks that South Dakotans stepped up to the plate to protect themselves, their neighbors, or not people they didn't even know. He talked about the Boy Scouts, another individual, schools, children that would come and fill sandbags and really helped protect our communities, our homes, our families, our neighbors during that difficult time. Some of the other issues that the governor talked about, of course, he wants this budget that the lawmakers will be working on over the next 35 days to remain conservative. He does plan on spending 99% of what is projected with some cushion there in the event that there are some changes. There were some other things that the governor talked about. Infant mortality death. It's a big issue for the governor. We'll see some more ways that the governor hopes to decrease the infant mortality death numbers. We'll hear those as we work through the session. It looks like Kara is already with somebody on the House floor. We'll throw it down to Kara.
And I'm on the floor here now talking with Representative Tom Bruner, the chairman of the House Education Committee. Welcome. Thank you for being here. A lot of education initiatives by the governor, your reaction, and a lot of work to do.
Well, we knew that last year, after doing basically just cutting, we had to do more. We had to expect more. We had to step up our game, provide, if we're going to provide less money, we have to step our game and make it better for teachers. Here's some incentives he's laid out. A clear path to having improving our test scores and improving teacher pay. And I think it's exciting. These are some very powerful initiatives he's laid out. And as committee chairman, I'm kind of looking forward to the discussion. I'm sure not everything is going to be popular with everybody. But as we work through the process, and these bills have been pre-filed, so I've had wind of them for a few weeks, and there's some big bills with a lot of stuff in them, a lot of repealing parts of law, so it'll be good.
And when you say increasing teacher pay, this is strictly the bonus program that he laid out, correct?
Yes, I'm talking about the bonus program he's laid out, yeah.
And that's going to take full buy-in by every legislator, to body years down the road for this to continue.
And that's typically the problem we've seen in the past is programs that come in 2 years from now that's a whole new body. Are they going to buy into that? So we not only have to have the enthusiasm to get it started, but we have to keep the enthusiasm to keep it going. And that will come a lot from teachers. When we have a successful program that teachers are appreciating and doing well in, Then there'll be the buy-in on their part, and we'll be able to keep it going. There'll be the pressure to keep it going. So I'm excited. Obviously, you know, no legislature or any governor, for that matter, can encumber a future legislature. But there's some good, solid stuff here that I think we can work with.
What about ending the tenure program?
Well, there's a lot of us that have had problems with tenure, you know, in the past, and there's other bills that have always come forward, you know, to deal with tenure, try to curtail it. There's other bills this year that are coming forward to end tenure. I don't know. I think we'll there's so many fields in our state that don't enjoy tenure. I mean, you work hard, you do your job, you do a good job. It's not a problem. So I don't know exactly why teachers should be treated differently. Maybe it should be easier to get rid of the bad teachers. This certainly puts the tools in their hand to identify the bad teachers. Not that they're not trying, but maybe they just don't have the tools. And I'm sure along the way there'll be an opportunity to improve their performance. So I think overall it'll be good. There'll be a lot of discussion on that fact, I'm sure. I'm sure a lot of the school organizations won't appreciate that, but we'll see where it ends up.
All right, Representative Bruner, thank you so much for being with us today.
My pleasure.
Stephanie, back to you.
All right, thank you, Kara. I'm now joined by Representative Mitch Fargin from Flandreau. The energy level is a little bit different this year at this time than it was last year. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. The energy level is a lot more upbeat this year. Obviously, making those drastic cuts last year, we have more money to play around with and look at places that we can invest back into South Dakota. So it's a good thing, and everybody's doing more smiles this year.
Your overall thoughts on what you heard today from the governor?
Oh, I'm a little mixed. I'm happy with the economic development, especially focusing on rural communities. But then when it goes to education, after we took those drastic 8.6% cuts last year, and now we're going back in and attacking teachers on tenure pay and a lot of those other merit pay system that we've seen the last 10 years that haven't worked at the federal level, and now we're trying to implement that at the state level. I don't understand how that goes hand in hand with this positive, upbeat economic development program and what he wants to do in education.
Now, part of those changes, some of these teachers could see some pretty hefty bonuses. Is that a good idea?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that is a good idea, investing in those areas that we want, that we need in math and sciences. But then when you're sitting there and trying to punishing the other teachers or maybe taking away their tenure, tenure is the negative part of it. And that right there could really hurt our educational system and hurt the children's futures.
I want to go back and talk about the South Dakota Wins, the workforce initiative that the governor will be moving forward over the next 3 years. One of the big issues has to do with the health care, particularly those rural communities which you represent. There is a lack of health care workers in those areas. Give me your overall thoughts on the South Dakota Wins and how you think this could impact particularly a community like yours.
No, absolutely. I think the South Dakota Wins program, I like most of the stuff that they have in there, especially when you're looking at incentives to getting people into those healthcare educational services in the USD and SDSU with nursing and doctors and actually investing in their education. And that's exactly what we need to be seeing is investments into education, promoting investing or getting these students into those areas, because that's what rural areas really need. In Flandreau and Madison, we are benefiting our benefits from those programs in the past, and by growing them now, hopefully we can keep expanding.
All right, very good. Representative Mitch Fargent from Flandreau, thanks for being with us, sir.
Thank you.
All right, Kara, back to you.
Thanks, Stephanie. And joining us now is Senator Russ Olson, the Senate Majority Leader. Thank you for being here. And you were just saying to me before we went on air that it was you were looking forward to being here today because the conversation is about growth and not cuts.
Absolutely. I mean, there isn't one of us out here that wants to face cuts. And so when you start putting faces with those cuts, it makes it difficult for all of us to perform. And I think that, you know, with that last year's tough year behind us, now we can start to look at policy and new investments in South Dakota's economy. And that's what some of the governor's vision that he laid out today, I think, touches on very well.
Talk a little bit about the South Dakota Wins program and growing the workforce.
Yeah, the workforce development, economic development aspect of this, coupled with education, they really remind me. I mean, it's a visionary step by the governor. It reminds me a lot of Governor Janklow and some of the things he did for our state. And so I hope that people keep him and his family in their thoughts and prayers as we move through the next days of our legislative session. You know, with the workforce development, we constantly, my mortgage-paying job, I get to work with companies on expansion and retention efforts. So they're always saying, you know, what are you going to do to bring in more people. 3.8% unemployment is great for the rest of us to look at and brag about in South Dakota, but as you're trying to recruit new companies in, that number kind of scares them off because there's no hope for new workforce to come in. And so having the retention or the recruitment effort with manpower, I think, is a very bold initiative with, you know, 1,000 more South Dakotans with $100 million economic impact. That's phenomenal.
Talk a little bit about the education initiatives and bonuses for teachers. Do you support this plan? Do you think it will be supported?
Well, you know, anybody that's went through an election cycle has heard from people saying that we always save education for last. It's always the last dollar that we worry about. And here we are the first day of the session talking about making the state's largest investment in teacher salary in our history. So I think it's a great concept. I think that, you know, you look at those critical areas of need like math and science, and finding a way to bonus those teachers is going to be a great recruitment and retention tool for them as well.
So it all plays together with the workforce.
I think that, yeah, you can't have economic development without an educated workforce. And so I think that it's nice to see a multi-year plan to address those needs.
It's going to take teacher buy-in, or let me rephrase that. Will it take teacher buy-in now or just legislative buy-in now to make these changes?
Well, I think that, you know, I'm interested to hear from my teachers. I think that, you know, the bonus that will start in 2014 of $5,000 for those top 20% performers goes to everyone. So it isn't just the math and science people. That was my initial concern, is that, you know, just math and science. But having the bonus out there, I mean, for to be part of the 20% of the top performers and to have that $5,000 bonus is also covers the rest of elementary ed all the way through high school. So, you know, it's a $150 million investment in teacher bonuses over the next 10 years. That's a big number, and I hope that it's viewed very positively.
Senator Olson, thank you for being with us. Stephanie, back to you.
Okay, I'm now joined by Senator Joni Cutler from Sioux Falls. Thanks for being with us, Senator. We talked a little bit with Mitch Fargin from the Democratic Party about the energy level. What are your thoughts on how things are going, I guess, on the first day?
Well, I have to say that I think this State of the State address is one of the best I've ever heard. I think the governor has provided both short and long-term strategies, setting the stage for a hopeful optimism for us. And I think his initiatives are sound. And I'm just thrilled to see the way that we are going to address things like workforce development and education.
So we have a pretty good idea what the big issues will be as we move forward from what we heard from the governor today. From your own perspective and some of the issues that you'll maybe be pushing from your constituents, anything you want to tell us about?
Well, I think there's, again, interest in short-term lending. I continue to hear from citizens about some of the things that probably could use some more consumer protection in that area, and other legislators have contacted me as well. So we're looking at that, and we're looking at some things, of course, with domestic violence and how to improve things for victims in our state as well.
Okay, some good stuff. One of the areas that we are anticipating to hear a lot about is the texting and driving. What are you hearing?
I think we'll have another lively discussion about texting and driving, and I think it's one of those things that it's taken time to educate people about the special distraction that texting presents as a public safety issue. And maybe this is the year that we can get that done.
As we came into this, the discussion was whether the governor would try to convince the legislature that we needed to hold steady with the budget, or if this was indeed a time where we could add new programs and whatnot. From what you heard today, do you think we will try to hold steady with what was passed last year, or do you see a lot of attempts to add new programs?
I don't know that it's so much new programming as it is a refocus on priorities that we already have, and I'm just very hopeful. I think we're addressing some key issues that can set the stage for very positive change in our state, both ensuring good quality government and also setting the stage for the future.
Right. Again, Senator Joni Cutler from Sioux Falls, thanks for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
All right. And Kara, we'll throw it back down to you.
Thanks, Stephanie. And joining me now is Representative Bernie Hunhoff. Thanks for being here. And the Democratic reaction to what you heard today.
Well, I was hoping this could be a rebuilding year, that we could start to dig ourselves out of the hole that we created last year. And I'm still hopeful, but, I mean, this speech didn't really help any. right at the end, he hit us with all sorts of things that I could only call a war on the schools. I mean, if you're going to really talk about slashing tenure, stopping tenure, ranking teachers, and the merit pay sounds good on the surface, but it just doesn't work in practice. These are really political reforms, Tea Party reforms, I'd say, that are being practiced in other states, in New Jersey and Wisconsin. We don't need that Tea Party extremism in South Dakota. It just doesn't fit our situation. So I was disappointed in that. I was encouraged by the talk that, or the recognition, I would say, that education, I think, is the best form of economic development. I kind of heard that in between the lines, I think, and that we haven't done enough in education to solve our workplace crisis. It's too bad it took a workplace crisis before we realized that, but we have not been investing in education the way we needed to. I think, again, you could kind of hear that between the lines, and there's a recognition that we need to do more in that area. That's good news.
Some people were saying earlier that this is a boost in teacher pay, a boost in salary, and do you think you're going to have teacher support for these initiatives?
No, I think the education community is going to be shocked, and I think it's going to be very controversial, and it comes at a horrendous time. I mean, the schools already feel under assault, many of them very beleaguered. They've been underfunded for years. In fact, some of the information we heard today suggesting that the schools are overfunded, it just doesn't fit reality. In fact, if you compare what we spend per pupil to any neighboring state, we're far beyond all neighboring states. I guess that would be the best comparison. The teachers are doing so much more today than they were doing in 1971 when the governor graduated from high school. He referenced that date. Today we have nutrition programs and, you know, technology programs. Blackboards cost more than cost a lot less than computers. Just special education, which he did mention. The schools are vastly different places than they were 40 years ago when I was in high school. And it's just changed so much. So it's apples and oranges, and it sends the wrong message. Our schools are really underfunded by any honest analysis. And Democrats are going to offer a bill this year that will encourage a conversation on what does it actually cost to educate a K-12 student. We need to come up with that figure, and we need to have the debate on what it really costs. And if we can come up with a figure, and I think we should do it probably by comparing us to other states in the region, come up with a figure and see where we're at. I suspect that we're going to be way below where we ought to be, and then we can at least have a target figure and we can start to shoot toward that target. That's the real conversation. These nickel-dime reforms and putting one-time monies here and one-time monies there, you know, any money's better than no money, but these one-time things are not the solution. We need to figure out how to move forward with a real school funding formula.
And the South Dakota Wins program, is there support from the Democrats for that?
Absolutely. What I heard from the governor today was that it was an acknowledgement that education is the best economic development. That's a big step forward. And we may not agree with all the details, but basically the concept that we need to invest more in workforce and not in brick and mortar, not in smokestack chasing, that's a departure. That's good news. That's what we've been talking about, and we'll support him there.
Okay. Representative Hunhoff, thank you for being with us.
Thank
I appreciate you. It. Stephanie, back to you.
And we're now joined by the Senate Minority Leader, Jason Frerichs. Thanks for being with us, Senator. Your background, you used to teach at the Tech School in Watertown, part of the South Dakota Wins program. We'll try to, I guess, educate more welders, more engineers, that type of thing. Give me your idea on what you've heard, and if you agree with it, if you like his plan, what do the Democrats hope will happen with it?
Definitely. It's certainly great to see the focus on technical education. For many years, technical education has been thought of as only being in workforce development or kind of being off by its side. Right now, the governor has put it front and center, meaning technical education is part of our future to move ahead as a state here in South Dakota. And so this technical education is for all types of students. Those who plan to go on to four-year degrees, those who plan to enter the workforce right away, and obviously, just like we've mentioned, you know, those that may go through the technical institute, and of course, welding, machinists, any of those type of fields that we have a strong need. And I'm glad to hear that the governor wants to put a really clear focus in those need areas, because we have employers not only in the southeast part of the state, but up in the northeast where I come from. We have employers that just simply cannot find trained workers, and so it's nice to hear. I have a few concerns on laying out the complete plan, and there's obviously, you know, minor tweaks that we could do here and there. But specifically from the Democrats, we have committed to also offering a scholarship program. And this is something we released even last week, that this scholarship program would fit really nice within the South Dakota Wins program. So that way, those young people who want to attend a technical institute in a critical need area could receive some scholarship funds.
Now, the Democrats were able to send out a press release on some of their proposals that will start unfolding, unraveling this session. Any idea how soon we might see some of those bills introduced?
Well, the bills will be introduced fairly readily because we are in a 35-day session, which speeds things up fairly fast. And myself, I'm looking forward to get back to the farm, and so it's nice come March 2nd we can be back there to take care of things. But at the same time, we have the people's work to do here in Pierre, and so we plan to move those forward. Right now, we're in the mode of gathering sponsors, making sure that we can bring our friends from the Republican side on board, if possible, and offer their ideas into some of what we would like to see done. And at the same time, we hope that the Republicans will ask us to participate in some things that they will be working on. And like our initiative kind of centers around, aside from preparing for the jobs, we want to make sure that we are continually looking at economic development in terms of taxes and things that need to be done. But then lastly, is this responsible government? And the governor said that he has worked on putting some things on the state website. We want to continue to encourage him to do more of that because it simply is in the public's best interest.
You mentioned you're want to get back to the farm. We heard very little, if anything, about ag in the governor's speech today. Does that worry you? Does that concern you? Will we see a lot of ag-related bills brought to the forefront this session?
I think we will see a few agriculture-related bills, and one area specifically will be perhaps in water management. We might see something to the effect of dealing with whether it's the counties or development districts or watershed districts or whoever is going to have some involvement on water drainage or management. It's a real issue, and I get calls every single day from constituents who feel strongly on that issue. At the same time, in agriculture, we haven't heard anything in terms of infrastructure. We have roadways that farm-to-market roads, along with rail systems and things that really are critical to move our product. And those are things that I continue to be focused on. But at the same time, I'm not certain on what the particular legislation will be. But as we know, things will move along fast, and so it better come together sooner rather than later. Otherwise, we know that, like I said, March 2nd will be here before we know it.
All right, thank you. And again, Senator Jason Frericks, the Minority Leader for the South Dakota Senate, joining me today as we wrap up our coverage of the State of the State Address. For all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, we encourage you to stay with us as we can continue all of the legislative action as it unfolds, whether you're listening on the radio, logging into the website at sdpb.org, or tuning in for all of our State House programming. I'm Stephanie Rissler alongside Kara Hetland. Thanks for being with us.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. Thank you for your annual membership through the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional programming funds provided by SDN Communications, powering intelligent networks across 8 states. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.